Hi, I'm Phil Gilmore with the Northern Utah .NET Users Group. Welcome to our next video in our Scary Gadgets collection, Switching Control Using Raspberry Pi. This video builds on my previous video, Servo Control Using Raspberry Pi. It's expected that you've already watched that video, because I'm going to skip some of the more elementary concepts as I continue here. Once again, I'm going to hook up my jumper wires to pin 11 and to ground, so I'll count 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11. And next, I remember that this corner pin is a ground. This is a ULN2003 Darlington array. They run about 50 cents. A Darlington pair is a pair of transistors wired together to make a super sensitive transistor. This chip contains 7 of them. I recommend using it for any and all switching applications when using the Raspberry Pi. The COM pin provides flyback protection for inductive loads. That means anything with an electromagnetic coil in it. This includes DC brush motors, stepper motors, relays, transformers, solenoids, valves, etc. Anything with a coil in it. These Darlingtons will switch the cathode or ground of your circuit, so don't try to put them in line on the positive feed to your motor or device. It must be wired to connect the ground. Here's the schematic we'll be using. Here's my 3-pin, 2-row jumper header. And this is our Darlington array. We're only going to be using one of the Darlington pairs. I've drawn a symbol for the transistor right in the middle of it, and the leads going in and out of it so that we can follow along later. This is the schematic symbol for a resistor. You don't have to worry much about what it does, just know that you always have to pair a resistor with an LED. This one could be anywhere between 220 ohms and 470 ohms. 470 is safer. And this is the symbol for a light emitting diode, or LED. That's the load that we'll be switching in our demo. This is my 4.5 volt battery pack. The right side is the positive, the left side is the negative. I'm going to build my circuit now, starting with my 3x2 header jumper. Next, I'll connect the power pack. Note that once again I have a battery removed for safety, so we're not powering our circuit before it's complete. Next, I'll connect the COM pin to the positive rail. This is very important to do if you're using an inductive load. This is what gives us our flyback protection. Next, I connect pin 8 to the negative rail. This is the emitter that's shared by all of the transistors inside this chip. Now the resistor needs to come off the power rail, and I'll put it in a hole just diagonally away from this collector. That allows me to connect the LED directly between the resistor and the collector of the chip. The LED is sensitive to polarity, so make sure the longest lead is connected to the resistor, not the collector. And here I connect the base of the Darlington pair to the signal from the Raspberry Pi's pin 11. I've also made a connection to connect the ground to the Raspberry Pi. These transistors are electronic switches. The base turns on a connection between the emitter and the collector, shown here. Each of the 7 transistors has the base on the left of the chip and the collector on the right. Pin 8 on the left is a shared emitter. They correspond one-to-one. They're all across from each other. Here's one way to visualize this. A signal comes from Raspberry Pi and hits the base of the transistor, connecting the collector and emitter. This completes the second circuit to drive our switched load. Let's have a look at some code. Most of this should look familiar. First, we import the Raspberry Pi GPIO library and give it an alias. Next, we import the sleep method from the time namespace. Next, we specify that we'll reference pins in board mode, and we set up pin 11 for output. Here's where we deviate a little bit. We're going to have a loop that sends just a digital signal on and then off with a 2-second delay. We'll repeat this a few times and be done. And of course at the end we call cleanup. Let's give it a try. Let's get fancy and see if we can't use PWM to make this LED fade on and off. The first few parts of this project are identical to the previous. Nothing new here. But here we'll set up a PWM object like we did with our servo motors. We'll set a couple of simple timing and delays for our loops and start the PWM signal. Now we have the same loop we did in our previous example, but inside this one, we won't just turn it on, but we will fade it from off to on, and then on to off. So to fade on, we start with a duty cycle of 0 and increment it with a slight delay all the way up to 25% duty cycle. And then we do the same thing in reverse to dim it down. Our duty cycle ended at 0, but we still want to send a stop on the object to terminate the signal completely. And of course we need to play friendly with the hardware and relinquish it when we're done. Now let's give this one a try. It may not show in the video, but if you try this experiment yourself, you can see that this is not a very smooth dimming. It jerks around a lot. That's primarily because we're using software PWM. The Raspberry Pi supports hardware PWM, but this particular software library does not. So when we use software PWM, the Raspberry Pi is actually generating the signal using software, but that software can be interrupted by the multitasking system. So in order to get a nice smooth PWM signal, we would probably have to use a C library in order to get that hardware PWM access. That may be a bit of a disappointment, but for some applications, such as in our previous video where we were using servo motors, this is not a big deal. It's not quite so obvious. In this demonstration, an LED is very responsive and it becomes much more obvious. So it depends on the application. You'll have to decide for yourself. But now using this information, hopefully you'll be able to wire it up and give it a try.